So the last but certainly not the least session of the day, I'd like to invite Vijay Shekhar Sharma on stage. And we're looking at a really freewheeling conversation, so I'm going to try and make sure that our discussion is short and we move straight to audience very, very quickly.
Okay. You sit on the equal chair first.
Yeah. Okay.
Nobody should be one up.
I haven't sat in one of these. So, Vijay, I'm trying to understand what's happening in the mobile VAS ecosystem right now. What's changing? Is there a bloodbath?
No, it's not bloodbath. It's people are killing themselves. They're internal getting killed by ailments. So it's not bloodbath. Bloodbath is when somebody kills someone else. Right now, people are killing themselves or getting killed by their own ailments.
How bad is it in terms of numbers?
Some of the surveys, if they were getting revenues of 100 in a month, a couple of days back, they're now 17, 18. So you can guess it's gone up to 80% decline in a service too. Some of the service which are growing, so average you can take 40% decline definitely across industry, and real decline should be at least 60%, I assume.
So what do you think companies should do right now?
Different companies should have their own plans, and I believe, like in the morning we talked to Molly and he was sharing how he has his own business plan. This is the time for discovery or rediscovery, as the word is.
Okay. But what was happening before in terms of the mobile VAS ecosystem and the way they were working with operators and billing customers, what's your take on that? That's a business that's been going on for a while, you've been aware of it. And you built your business in that same ecosystem.
Correct.
So what's your take on it?
This ecosystem or the mobile VAS industry, I think the making money in this industry is really, really very low brainer job. It's a very low entry barrier. You have to just partner with a few of the VAS guys and you are on the roll to make money. It's such a bad industry in the sense of entry barriers. You can enter easily, but if you want to scale it, then that is a little more tough here. So you will see 1,000 players making 10 lakhs to 1 crore a month on and so on, and then very few who will grow annually more than 100 crores. Because scale requires real meat, and entry and making some bucks is everybody's business. So making business when everybody is here, more like hyenas. I've used this term quite a few times in, I still remember 2006, 2007, 2008, and I said that all these VAS companies are sort of hyenas looking at consumer's wallet, and they are out there to race to take the money out of it. And the best one gets most of it, and everybody gets some of it.
So have you done any of this?
In the industry? I think there is no one who will say that I have not done it. At the same point in time, the good guys have an understanding of that it is not what is real. The guys who are in it just to make cash do it, like even in the blatant days like these days. So industry is going through a classic problem of bad people still in the play, still making money, not getting blacklisted or even getting thrown out. The vested interest of some of those who are on the other side of the table and sort of nexus between those two guys. I've been firing people from my company. They don't have a clue of what the business is or what is the business's long-term roadmap is, but they're getting more money by making another company quickly and becoming a content provider to telco, and then telco letting them do it, and some of the guys end up making even their monthly revenues, which are pretty decent. They make more money than Nikhil Pahwa of MediaNama. I wish you
that
could start a company.
That's not really a benchmark.
Alright, so that they make more money than your NH7 or most sincere the people who will try making money without an extraordinary amount of value proposition on the table.
So, what are you doing to change things?
We're changing things for us. We can't change the ecosystem. Ecosystem has to discover its own path. I believe that consumers will change their consumer expending. It's all because telco is a platform which allows many apps and content to come. And telco as a platform is relevant only in feature phone scenarios. because for smartphones, the customer just zooms out to the internet app store or open internet. We believe, I personally believe, consumers will move faster and regulator will curb all feature phone based nonsense and will move to the smartphone ecosystem. I wish that it does it like quicker. At the same point in time, it will take at least 18-24 months still. We're moving that side. We're moving to the OTT play. We're moving to the consumer in front of consumer directly. The ecosystem, which is on the feature phone side, will remain as it is, except that it will be less relevant.
So are we moving towards a situation where, let's say, a year, 2 years from now, the 197 business will not exist and your Paytm business will? Or are you...
Is I don't that, think that 197 business definition is what the 197 business definition was in 2001 when I had my first customer. The beautiful thing when I heard one of the investors talking about me to another potential investor was, what we loved in this guy was that he pivoted quite a few times. That's a term, must be a value investor. So I'd say that I discovered new business models going forward, or businesses which are more relevant for today tomorrow versus yesterday today. And that's another junction that we're standing at. It's not to say that 197 business won't be there, it's to say which business line item will be more relevant for us and which we will be identified with. One of the best thing I can tell you is, for first trimester of my life, which was 2001 to 2004-05, I was known as a Panditji guy, astrologers. None of you might know in this room, we used to run a live astrology service and everybody knew us as those people who do live astrology service. Then in between, we were known as the guys who give platform for free and do the revenue share for the platform-based services. And quickly, once we got wiped out in this business model, because a big guy came, replaced us and so on, we started getting into app discovery, content discovery, and that business was known as ODD.
So which is something we are much maligned for.
I'll tell you what about. So soon we started becoming a company who was known for OBD. And I think some people in this industry still believe with OBD guys. And I'm like, what do you mean by you have OBD guys? Just because you have one app which is dominating doesn't make you OBD guys. Right? That said, you said you're maligned for that.
I mean, most people sort of take it as a blame that you're the OBD guys with the billing, especially on the billing side of things, right? And that's, historically, we get a lot of comments around that.
Okay, your soft question, I'll make it very straight, that your OBDs are the biggest fuck-up reason of this industry because you make customers activate these services through OBDs. That's the question, right?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, you're shooting the messenger here. And I keep saying it in one of those anonymous replies, which I make on your site, by the way. But you're shooting the messenger.
Are you VAS guy?
I am not the VAS guy anymore. I am not. I just keep seeing three more guys. I used to be, in when he was in Content Sutra, I was the VAS guy in those days, not now. Now, just remember, OBD in the value chain comes as a app discovery or selling opportunity. We are paid for making phone calls. We are not paid for, or we don't make maximum transaction value by OBD because it is that service which makes most of the money. So, giving an example, which is a very popular service, let's say ring back tone is service that we are trying to sell to the consumer. We make XYZ paisa, oh, these are three digits, X paisa for one call, and the content provider whose content will be sold will make up to 25% or 28% of that song cost, and a platform provider which is running subscription and customers platforms at the back will make somewhere around 10-20%. We make in paisa per call, these guys make a percentage of that big transaction value. My interest is aligned if this guy doesn't buy it so that I can make one more call to this guy. My interest does not lie in making this guy buy without his interest so that I don't make next call. So who does it? I'm being blunt, and I think the industry now knows it. Everything beyond go-to-market piece is where the cream of revenue and cream of all sorts of opportunity exists. The best case is one of the operator. So we became harsh about it after reading in your MediaNama, really. That nobody will be able to even name that these customers were acquired from this platform, because people might just internally used to do it. I later figured out some of the guys who do these comments are sitting inside operators or some of those VAS companies who get these customers. What happens is that guy will say, I got these customers through a VAS platform. Thank God to one of the operators who sent us this data saying, can you just find out, did you do the VAS when I asked you not to do this? We found out we didn't even make those phone calls, and the guy was reporting to the customer care, or CSD as they say it, that these are acquired through OBD. Internally, the CSD team asked this company to produce the logs at a time which we OBD platform would have sent them. Answer was, the guy produced logs. I mean, look at the blatant example of the system. The logs were faked. Our system did not even generate a request. The system of that content provider showed that there are these logs. So finally, this guy got blacklisted and whatever not. So
are we operating in a cleaner ecosystem now?
Cleaner is a good word. Clean is not complete.
Okay. Just moving on, I wanted to understand what you're building with Paytm, because it's seen as a very low margin business. Where are you going with this?
So, in the feature phone market, we were a discovery platform and we were selling some of the content services. Internally, we look at content as some of the digital goods. So we started learning, if we were to convert all our feature phone business into a smartphone era, we have to do things that we know ourselves for. So these digital, the content became a part of a larger number of digital goods that we can sell to the consumer. The marketing platform on 2G became marketing platform on 3G, all our ad network and whatnot that we have to build there. And then in the 2G environment, payment is sorted out because you have a telco's bottomless wallet, nearly. Anybody can attempt to get anything out of it, literally. So that has to be converted into payment platform. So our business from feature phone to smartphone will look in this tone. But one of the most critical thing that we had to do was replicate telco's impulse buy capability of wallet into our new world scenario. And that is where the Paytm as an opportunity came, where we started building a smartphone or mobile internet's true payment platform, where the payment is not just from operator as an option, but is from banks, cell phone, wallet, and so on. That's why the name called Pay Through Mobile. Soon we have to learn that we have to have a captive merchant who will use this platform, and that is when we launched Paytm based one service which every name wants, which is pay for your prepaid or DTH, which is where we launched Paytm. So it's a captive interface of our payment platform. Today it has become itself a big platform, and we will take it from there for its next set of journeys, where we will sell more digital goods. So Flipkart sells books, laptops, and computer, and Home Shop sells sarees. We will sell everything which is in digital in nature, starting from top-ups and tools.
So what's next? What are you launching next in terms of digital goods? Top-ups is one. Do you move to music? Would you license music for selling?
I am a firm believer of, if you run a business based on royalties, you are doing charity to someone, not your business. You're not in your business. You're doing a charity of discovery of business model for that guy who owns licenses. So we will not be the guys who will take music royalties and sell to a consumer. We might be the guy who can make it available and do a transaction of selling, but somebody else will do the fulfillment and so on, if music was one of those. That said, I think we started doing a few casual apps already.
No, we still have about 15 minutes. That's a 15 minute timer.
So, we will do games, we will do apps, we will do deals, which if you go on the Paytm second page, there are deals. And soon we will launch something different, which we'll keep it for the time when we launch.
So, how do you address the issue of, let's say, on payments on mobile, because through the OTP, that must be a big pain point. Online, you're facing a slightly easier situation with people who are used to paying online, perhaps. How do you address that situation, particularly on mobile?
Everybody who's doing online internet business is as ignorant about mobile as much was an online offline guy when the online was coming. So way back, 10 years back, if some people do not understand what internet is. I can tell you those people who understood internet do not understand what is mobile. So we trying to build a payment platform for mobile bottom up. So PayTM Payments, which is our payment platform, has a capability and made for mobile interface. Now, obviously, we can't map the net banking to it, but debit credit we can do very well, and we do them very well. We do net banking. We do have a net banking interface on that. Our belief is that we have to build a proxy interface for all your internet-driven digital payments, net banking, credit debits, if at all. And to do that, we built in a layer called wallet, which is where the Paytm wallet arrives, which is called Paytm Cash. Already we have a closed loop wallet inside our Paytm platform. It's somewhere upward of 1.6 million users already on that who are using wallet platform. Over the period, we hope to create a larger wallet platform which will do the proxy of internet transactions, and then mobile especially will become mobile first transaction.
You look to do a retail rollout like an Oxy Cash or a Suvidha?
No, I'm not into a retailer's digital wallet. We are into consumer's digital wallet.
Because it's about putting money in the wallet, in the digital wallet that you have.
The problem in these Oxy, Suvidha, it's is these are proxies for consumers, these are not consumers' wallet. They are PCO's wallet, they are that Xerox guy's wallet, they are that railway ticket booking guy's wallet, they are not the consumer's wallet. So our wallet strategy is driven by acquiring consumers to make wallet, which is why we are consumer driven, branding it directly from the consumer instead of rolling out in retail where immediately we start getting into these consumers.
So who are you competing with right now?
In which business?
Actually, that's a question as well, in each business.
Yeah, so I mean, which business you want to ask about, the wallet?
In terms of Paytm, who are you competing with right now?
Paytm Payments? So let me just go back to it. This is an elaborative question, I don't know, but how to quickly go to it. So Paytm payment platform, we would compete with people who are in payment platforms. Incidentally, India has payment platform owned by banks, so there is no true payment platform in the country, any which ways. Everybody does a job of being an aggregator of payment gateways. So we are mainly an aggregator of payment gateway when it is called Paytm Payments. Our intention is to be a payment platform, which includes significant extra value as them being an aggregator. I will give away the one of the most cliched one, analytics for the merchant, which is 98% except 2% of Paytm payment aggregators don't do, which means that we will compete with everybody who is aggregating payment gateways. In the wallet case, we will compete with everybody who is doing wallet. In the online top-up, which we today sell, we are competing with online top-up sites. Then we are competing with operators themselves because operators are captive top-up sites. And then, if we launch few more things, we will compete with that guy. I mean, in a full ecosystem integrated, I don't think probably something.
So one part of monetization for, let's say, businesses, content businesses, let's say, on the mobile would be the entire aspect of integrating Paytm payments, for example. The other one would be advertising.
By the way, I just want to tell you, content, Paytm payments are like left and right side.
Okay.
That's for operator wallet to charge.
So are you becoming the new operator in that sense?
Operator of prepaid wallet? Yes. We wish that we had 100 million prepaid customers of ours. Who didn't wish that? And they were buying some things through our wallet?
So
yes.
Is that a direction that you want to go in? That you want to become the new operator because you're controlling the payment ecosystem?
When you say operator means what? The
like
Excel operator?
Like right now the mobile operator controls the payment ecosystem. Do you
mobile operator cannot control payment ecosystem because Government of India and RBI has clearly said, and even the consumer of this country has clearly said that operators are someone who I don't trust.
Let me rephrase the question. This is right now what happens is that if someone is selling content on the mobile, they're billing through the mobile operator. That's what the VAS industry was. And are you trying to create a situation in the off-tech world where the Paytm wallet then becomes something that content owners can integrate with, and therefore you in that sense own the customer?
For foreseeable future, Paytm wallet will not be utilized for any content service we sell to the consumers. People who sell content services to consumers are looked at by consumers as distrustworthy, and trustworthy, we will never let content business of anyone or any type of content service touch our Paytm sacrosanct wallet. We are here to drive trust of consumer, and content and consumer trust are left and right.
Okay. So the other part of the question was about mobile advertising. What's your take on that? What are you doing in that particular space?
So, incidentally, mobile advertising is everybody's fancy business. It's not so-called large business.
Because payments on mobile are tough, and maybe monetization to advertising is great, right?
I'd say the payment is an easier business. You can build a $1 billion transaction business on if you have a payment method, but you can't build a $1 billion advertising driven business for next 5 years for sure in India. And keeping Google apart or Google's publishers inclusive, no one publisher or no ad network itself sitting in India being for Indians will do $1 billion ever in next 5 years for sure. But ever in next 5 years, right? But you have a payment and you are asking consumers to pay for it, you can do a $1 billion gross. So advertising for us is more about customer acquiring for paying businesses. So our advertising business is to drive consumers to places where we have consumers paying for us service.
Okay. Does anyone in the audience have questions?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Hello. Yeah. So yes. Hey. So the first question is, you know, the perception is that because there was Google Analytics, that's the reason why online advertising picked up. Now, if you're saying that you have certain analytics, doesn't that give you an advantage in mobile advertising?
Yes.
Okay. The next thing is when you mention mobile wallet. Where is the money? If you're saying that, you know, because obviously we're not like M-Pesa or something where the network keeps all the money. In the mobile wallet case, you know, where is the money being kept if you're saying it's not kept with the content aggregator or the operator?
First of all, I never said mobile wallet. I said self-owned wallet. Wallet that 197 owns. Consumers keeps money with 197. Mobile is an interface to transact on that wallet. And it's mobile first wallet, which means mobile will be natively taken care of. Where the money is kept? Money is kept in 197's affiliate escrow bank account.
Perfect, thanks.
You said there's about 1 million plus subscribers on the wallet, right?
Correct.
What percentage of it is actually driven by failed transactions?
Majority, 60 plus. So 60% would be.
So through the payment gateway, what percentage of transactions actually fail right now?
Oh, that's a Paytm payment pages payment discussion.
Mm-hmm.
We are aiming less than 5%.
Okay.
We just crossed 2-digit milestone, meaning 90%+ are.
So if you actually don't automatically convert a lot of the guys who are being driven from failed transactions, I would say the number is actually quite low.
We every day have plus 3,000 people voluntarily depositing money.
Plus, sorry, and get that?
Plus 3,000, 3,000 plus.
Okay, cool.
Hi, my question is on a little bit of the wallet. Just trying to understand that from your aspect, the revenue model for you, are you taking a transaction cost and who are you taking it from? And also a little bit more about trust. Obviously, then people are trusting you, right? They're trusting 197. So how are you building trust?
First of all, our wallet is meant to transact primarily on our destination called Paytm, where we are selling today top-ups, tolls, DTH, some of the utility things. We will go on to build a few more things in our own marketplace. To make it in our business plan understanding, you should look at our wallet on payment platform as Alipay, and you should look at it more like a shop which is native to Alipay. It's called Taobao, but it is not yet in a marketplace zone that we've reached. So hopefully we will reach into a marketplace zone much, much later in our life cycle, if it takes that. So the wallet is meant to transact on our own self. That's the first answer. Trust is incredibly most important asset that we will inherit, build, keep, differentiate it. We internally have a customer care team which is, I can take a pride of, try tweeting, something happened to your Paytm transaction, and it's an SLA internally that you're driving, couple of minutes that you should have an answer itself on Twitter and so on. Trust is driven by customer trust. When you have, you going through a sinking feeling together with the customer and you bring him out and he feels happy about it, that's the moment you earned a trust and you picked a trust. Now this guy will refer to the next guy. Trust is built 1% at a time and then it gets into virality. Today, we are proud to say that more than 2.8 million people on Paytm have exhibited that trust and they are referring it to the next guy. Any day when we get customers on our website of 100 people, 73 are those who have transacted earlier on a site, which is the acknowledgement of trust that I can put here. We believe that trust will be built when there is a situation and we came out of it together. We believe trust will be built when there is a peer reference. That's why we bother about social conversations. We believe trust will be built when we just heard it in the last NH7 conversation, we'll do ATL, brand name. Let's see if we first 2 hours what are driving today, later things are yet in the queue.
Just one small thing, you just mentioned tweeting and you show sort of a smartphone here. What is your average customer? Are they on smartphones? Are they tweeting? Is that the normal customer or are they on feature phones or?
In fact, our approach is that we will address alpha customers first, so we are deliberately first iPhone. Internally, we didn't build other builds of OS before we built iPhone.
But you're mentioning this number of 2.7 million.
Correct.
Are they all on iPhone or most of them on iPhone or?
Most of the, so let me just say, of the transaction that we do every day, highest used interface beyond internet, the platform, will be iOS, then will be Java, then will be Android.
For you guys?
Sorry?
For you.
For us.
And then what percentage is, I'm just curious, because obviously, we in the market, we see the opposite. We see Android as having the highest usage, and you're saying for you, it's the lowest usage.
iOS users are more consumer value-driven, user experience-driven, and probably somewhere over there, Twitter-centric or... Yeah.
But out of the 2.7 million, I'm just trying to understand, is it 20,000, is it 2,000, is it 2 million?
100,000 iOS and a couple of 100,000. Let's say 300,000 probably on Android and another 400,000 on Nokia, Java.
And then the rest, that's like a million?
Internet.
A million, okay, thank you.
Internet, mobile internet or internet.
Yeah, so before we end, just wanted to get a sense of, there's something which you feel very passionate about, the entire startup ecosystem in India. What are you doing about it? What do you think needs to be done in order to make it like a Silicon Valley? I know you wanted to move to Silicon Valley, you said it a few times. What do you think needs to be done?
On 18th, I'm going to Silicon Valley. Okay.
Are you moving?
I'm taking flight and coming back, so moving.
Yes, moving.
Yeah. I mean, the problem with the country has been, so startup ecosystem is sort of a circle, early idea stage, talent, early days funding, mid stage, late stage funding, and exit. The problem lies in the last part, exits. There is nothing that can exit in the country. There are no companies who are buying companies. E-commerce companies buying each other, I don't have a clue what they are buying, and they are not incentivizing people to create e-commerce companies for sure. Those buys are considered more like investors taking care of each other. Which brings to a situation that there is no reason for you to build the first value chain unless you have an exit opportunity via an IPO. Which brings us to Indian IPO requirements are 3 years profitable, and stock market requires somewhere about 50-60 crores minimum profit, which means you're talking about 200 of crores of revenue. I mean, startup is not a problem, it's an exit that is a problem. At our level, we wanted to find out companies which are doing better than what we could assume in some of the segments. For example, like we didn't do a good job at a point of time in apps, so we were very keen on companies which were doing apps. At one point in time, we didn't have a clue how will the mobile internet access will work. So if we invest in companies which are doing mobile internet access play and so on. So our investments in a startup ecosystem is driven by what's our company's strategy and what is the job that we can't do. That's why we invest in some of those companies.
But aren't most of your investments out of India? Outside of India?
Yeah. So I never said I'm doing anything for startup ecosystem.
What about, so you're not doing anything for the startup ecosystem in India is what you're saying?
In India, there are many companies which are doing something that incredibly differentiates them. That said, we are today completing a company acquiring process, which is an Indian company. We invested in a company out of Bangalore. We invested in a company out of Kerala. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that I'm doing something for a startup ecosystem, because the best I can do for an Indian startup ecosystem is I can acquire so many startups. That is what is needed. At an investment stage, we are very selfishly looking at companies that are fitting into our corporate agenda.
Okay. Who are you acquiring?
Today? I will tell you tomorrow.
Does anyone have any more questions?
Startup agenda?
On the startup situation?
We'll just do the reverse. Nikhil ke question karenge.
What?
Yeah? 220? 220? Achha, 2020. 2020, where do I see myself? Retirement is overrated. Rupert Murdoch will be dead. Jobs is dead. I will be alive. Very cryptic. It just simply means I wish I could do something what Jobs did. I wish I could have audacity what Murdoch has. I wish that, you know, I wish. Now those guys are done with, I'll be remaining, and let me see where did I do what I did. Now, does it mean that will I be, is it a locational question? I don't have an answer to that. If it is a scope of work question, I wish that we would have done a couple of billion dollars revenue, if that was one of the things that I can benchmark at.
Great.
Yeah, so we have a question for Nikhil, and this was part of my understanding with what Nikhil does. Nikhil, so what do you do at MediaNama?
Yeah, that's a question I keep asking myself as well. Pretty much everything. I change some of the site's code. I do the editorial along with the great editorial team we're setting up. I do sales. I plan the next few months because we operate on a 3 to 6 month cycle.
Are you supporting founders who does not have a team and can't hire a team?
No, I think it's about scale and opportunity. That's the way I see it. And I'd mentioned some of the issues in the earlier sessions about cash flow issues in the ecosystem, particularly the advertiser-driven ecosystem. So I'm trying to figure out ways of addressing that in scale. We're bootstrapped, and so we need to make sure that we use revenues to scale rather than take on debt.
So your primary business model is earning advertisers' revenue. Does it mean that your editorials are influenced by advertisers?
Not at all. In fact, we've turned down advertisers. Even for this conference, for example, there are about six to ten companies who we said no to because they wanted speaker slots. As far as I'm concerned, the editorial on the site, the space on the stage is basically sacrosanct. That's
actually,
not
I can
that.
Vouch for it. We must be one of the one or two number spender on this conference, and I have opportunity when there are 10% of people who are in the room who are in the morning. So the guy pushes like everyone out of the stage. Is that what you, do you think you will be able to sustain your business by being this cynical?
It's not cynical, it's honest and it's ethical. That's the way I look at it.
Honest? Who bothers?
So I also don't bother with this. So the way I look at things is that I'd rather do things right because it's a personal choice, and I've done my business on those lines. And I'd said this in fact while I was at Content Sutra, that if Content Sutra wasn't ethical and if it wasn't independent of advertiser pressure, I wouldn't be in that. And that's one of the reasons why I for a very long time avoided getting into the media business. And it's the same thing here. If it isn't independent and ethical, then I wouldn't be doing it. It's more about what I want to do.
Very interesting. Now, you are accused of targeting one particular company which never advertised on your website, and the company was going through rough patches few months back, hopefully out of this now. And now seems like you got into truce, they just advertised here. Is that you signed a truce deal?
So frankly, from our side, there was never ever any
pressure of advertising on them.
No, and it was an opportunity. So
opportunities were already filled.
Let me answer, right? So you're talking about on mobile, and when they were going through trouble, we were being accused. We were being accused of being against them. But the fact of the matter is that what the rumors that were floating around, I'd heard them over a period of almost 2.5 months. We were never able to get any proof to validate what was going on. And therefore, even though I was checking internally with some sources in non-mobile, let me finish. We never reported it. It was ET who reported it, quoting sources, and we basically pointed out what ET had reported, and we pointed out towards the trajectory of the company over the past few years. So as such, we followed due process. Even when we published stories on during that time period, we asked them for the responses, and we always updated. So we followed due journalistic process in that.
We weren't
targeting them ever.
You are soft on your sponsors.
With some of the questions I asked you earlier today seem soft.
Are we the sponsors?
I think you have your name.
The point is, on your website, let's just be very honest about it.
Okay.
If auditors are paid by companies, they listen to what company wants to be published.
I'm not an auditor.
Let me just say this completely, right? That's why none of the auditors have been able to pass through the tests of time ever. They have been faltered, shown publicly times again. So who buys your bread decides somewhere or other, small or more, you not sold your complete soul, is what you're saying. Haven't you been soft with those guys who gave you money?
So one of the things that I sort of sometimes notice is that we are actually harsher on companies who've given us money. It's almost like another, it's almost...
We did a publicity stunt of making sure everybody listens to this. This is part of a pre-stage question answer.
What I'm saying is that at times we're actually, we sometimes overreach in terms of trying to be correct, and we're sometimes harsher, is what I've noticed.
People think you're being fake when you're being harsher on them.
I think we're running out of time, thankfully, so I'll end over here.
Let's get very blunt and honest about it.
This is the last question.
No, I have one more question then. Why the heck sometimes you close comments randomly? And you're having fun and just get stopped.
So here's the thing, right? It's one of the reasons is legal. We can be held liable for content for comments on our site which are anonymous. So I personally support anonymity, because I believe it gives the freedom for people to say what they want to say. But at the same time, there is a rule on the site that you can't say anything personal, you can't accuse or defame. So therefore we remove the comments, and if it's getting out of hand, we close comments. The only person on MediaNama who's allowed to be abused is me, because I don't care.
Wow.
That's the rule.
You're God.
No, I'm not. I just have a very thick skin because I'm
crocodile.
Because everyone keeps accusing me of something else. So I have a thick skin.
Oh, come on. Let's just get very clearly here.
People accuse me of being partial to some against others. So I am what I am. I deal with it. That's it.
Some of us sitting here in this audience are those anonymous ones who are commenting. I'm also one of those.
Yeah, I got that.
Damn, you track IP addresses to know who this real guy is.
No.
You still kick it.
I don't track IP addresses. We don't.
And you know, long time listener, repeat caller. Who's that guy? Tell us here now.
I know who he is because he's told me, and I know he's written some things about your company, but I can't reveal any names.
So, do you know who are these guys? Do you have sort of a liking of one guy to others?
No, I don't.
Do you like the handles, some handles more than other handles?
I like all the VAS guys. There's this one ID VAS guy, but they're all very interesting because, you know, we get insight from comments on some of the things that are going on, not able to verify most of it, but it's a part of trying to figure out what's. So I'll ask you some of the questions that I see mentioned in the comments. They do teach us, and one of the things I'm very thankful for is that what our readers tell us through anonymous tips, through the comments, we learn from all of this. We learn from calls that we get from people who don't really.
And finally, have you been sued yet?
We've got legal notices. We've got a threat to sue from.
To sue?
So we got a legal notice saying that they'll sue us. That was a monster because we published their financials online. But no one's followed through, thankfully, on that. And frankly, if someone does, we'd probably not survive it.
Do you have a backing of strong political figure or someone?
No, it's almost so it's slightly philosophical, but it's coming out of detachment.
Ooh.
If it goes, it goes.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nikhil Pahwa for you, the host of the today's day. Thank you, Nikhil, for giving us a nice conference in the city.
Thank you.
I'm proud of you.
Thanks, Vijay. Thanks.
I'm happy that we did this support as much we could.
Thank you for your support. Really.
We'll be hoping other editors of Nikhil's teams are also kind for us.
No promises on editorial level. Let me just keep that very clear. So this is.
I have one more question.
Okay.
Just in case. Hmm. You look straight. You are?
Sorry? Yes, I am.
Oh, that way.
Yes, I am.